There are times to part paths and methods in terms of how to part paths properly, and I think we learned something about that here. How to do so? Well, first of all, we need to do so reluctantly. Reluctantly. Listen, the length to which this discussion went demonstrates the fact that these brothers were not willing to split over trifles. You read this with you heard this read. The contention became so sharp that they parted from one another. Now, I read that to say there was an ongoing discussion here. And this is so important to us because we feel, if you're anything like me, I know you feel this way, and I know you're like me because we have like passions as one another, as Paul himself says in an earlier chapter. We want to split the second we get rubbed the wrong way. As soon as there's a conflict, as soon as someone offends us, our inclination is to separate. Well, I can't work with that person. There's conflict. Well, no, we need to split reluctantly. Now, I believe that Paul and Barnabas were not reluctant enough, that they could have reconciled, that they stuck to their own position so long, so hard, so heatedly, that eventually they were unreconciled. Let me read you this quotation from John Calvin. Very interesting, because Calvin is sometimes identified as a rigid, principled person who is never willing to bend or compromise. But this is what he says, commenting on this text. He says, we must moderate our desires, even in the best causes. We must moderate our desires, even in the best causes, lest it pass measure and be too fervent. Be too fervent. Now, Calvin was fervent. He stuck to his positions. He was principled. But he says, we need to be careful to make sure that we're not so principled, even in the best causes, that our desire becomes too fervent, and we actually end up defending ourselves over much. So we need to learn from what Paul and Barnabas experience here to separate or to part paths reluctantly as a last option. Secondly, and this somewhat offsets in a sense, or at least complements the previous point, to part paths properly, we need to do so realistically sometimes. We need to be realistic sometimes about the setting in which we're in. Here we have two church leaders who took significantly different approaches to ministry. And they came to the sad conclusion, it seems, that for the time being, they could not work together. Now, listen, for the time being, they could not work together. I think that's important. But they were realistic about it. Now, I say this reservedly, but in some relationships, some partnerships, we have to be willing to say, you know what, we just are going two different directions here, and humanly speaking, we don't see a way to resolve it. So we need to be realistic about our partnerships and realize that sometimes there is a fork in the road that we take the opposite side of with our friends. The third thing that we learn about parting paths properly here is that we need to do so graciously. Graciously. Now, here's something that I think is pretty clear didn't happen in this text. Now, listen, we can say that, right? We don't have to defend Paul and Barnabas to the hilt. It's not like they were perfect. In fact, as I mentioned in Acts 14:15, remember when the people of Lystra were about to sacrifice to Paul and Barnabas? And what did Paul and Barnabas say? They said, why are you doing this? Remember, we're men just like you. They say, we have the same passions that you do. We have the same emotions. We're hot-headed too, they could say, in reference to this text here. So, if there is a time when we need to part paths, we need to strive with all our energies to do so graciously. To be able to say, if it's in a Christian setting, you're my brother, you're my sister, this breaks my heart that we're separating here. We need to love each other, be gracious to each other, but realistically, I'm not sure how we can continue. So graciously. Fourth, if we're ever to part paths, and to do so properly with another partner, we should strive to do so consensually. Consensually, that is, with the consent or permission, advice, counsel, of someone who has authority over us. Right? We are... I speak directly to my own heart here. We are so reluctant to get counsel with regard to a matter. Why? Because we know best. Right? I know myself. I know my problem. I know best. And I know I can't work in this situation. I could explain it to somebody, but they're not going to understand. I'm going to leave. Now, where am I getting this from? Well, notice what is said about Paul and Barnabas. Paul and Silas. Now, I'm not necessarily trying to take sides here between Paul and Barnabas, but if we had to, I think we'd have to side with Paul. And here's why. Because verse 40 says, Paul chose Silas and departed, what? Being commended by the brethren to the grace of God. In other words, the church gives its blessing to Paul and Silas in the direction that they went. But you notice what's conspicuously absent from this text? Any reference to the church commending Barnabas and John Mark? Right? It seems that the church gave its blessing to Paul and Silas, in a sense saying, we agree with you, go with our blessing. It really does matter that we get counsel and consent from those who are in a position of authority in relation to us if we ever have to split paths. And yet we seem to be reluctant to do this. Right? The ministers are not consulted a lot of times in terms of separations or other matters and other governing bodies we seem to reject. We need to separate consensually if we ever need to. Finally, fifthly, to part paths properly, especially in the context of a Christian partnership, we need to do so optimistically. Optimistically, in other words, with a view toward reconciliation. If there is a breach between people or groups that ought to be together, if a separation occurs, it ought to be a sad separation that hopefully is not permanent. Now, where do we get this from? Well, it's very interesting that Barnabas, from this point on, disappears from the book of Acts. Never mentioned again. The story follows Paul from here on. But Paul later mentions Barnabas in 1 Corinthians 9, verse 6. And this is, of course, afterwards, because Paul hasn't even begun his Corinthian ministry yet. And he mentions him as a partner in ministry. In other words, Paul's not saying, hey, Barnabas, you know what? We disagreed. We're splitting, and I'm never going to talk to you again. I'm never going to count you as a brother. We're never going to work together again. No, he references Barnabas as a partner in ministry. Now, even more striking is what Paul says about John Mark later on. Now, what he says here is pretty undermining against John, right? We're not taking John Mark, Barnabas, because he didn't stick with us last time. But notice how Paul had become reconciled with John Mark towards the end of Paul's life. We see this in a beautiful reference in 2 Timothy 4. I'll read verses 9 through 11. There are other references here. Philemon 24, Colossians 4, verse 10, where Paul mentions Timothy and mentions John Mark in a positive light. But listen to this, 2 Timothy 4, 9 through 11. Paul, writing here to Timothy, says, be diligent to come to me quickly. Now keep in mind, Paul's in prison here and anticipates at least that his life is about to come to an end. Now we don't know whether he was martyred at this point or whether he survived some years, but regardless, he thought his end was coming. He says, I'm already being poured out like a drink offering. He says to Timothy, be diligent to come to me quickly, for Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, and has departed for Thessalonica, Crescens for Galatia, Titus for Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful to me for ministry. Now there's a 180, right? Barnabas, we're not taking John Mark. He's not useful for us in ministry. He's turned back. Now he says, Timothy, bring Mark with you. Bring John Mark with you. He's useful for me in ministry. The point is, friends, that there was a separation here, a sad separation, but I believe the brothers did so with a certain optimism, saying that as Christian people, we need to be reconciled again.